such a science, knowledge only adds to the excitement, the mystery, and the awe of a flower.
Evidence is evidence. It's public. Everybody can look at the evidence and assess it, and eventually, if there's enough evidence, come to the same conclusion.
Cockatoos with attitude. Cockatude.
Hello and welcome to Cockatude. Cockatoos with attitude. Episode 5, Roman. And this is Roman right here. And Coco, don't have a fit. Coco doesn't like the tripods. So she doesn't like to see all the cameras and things hanging around. So she has a little bit of a fit. We're trying to get her used to this. But today is about Roman, who used to be called Romeo. But we have found with some birds that if you slightly change their name when they have bad associations with the past, it seems to fade. So he prefers to be called Roman, don't you? Don't you? Yeah. Yeah. He was considered to be by many an aggressive bird, but he looks pretty aggressive now, doesn't he? Do you look aggressive? Huh? Do you look aggressive? You just look so aggressive. Roman was at an animal hospital for many years, and they cared for him, and he did really well. He had a strong personality, and he liked the cage that he had outside, and he had a friend there named Lucy, and although they never were mated, they were good friends. And high sugar, white sugar, high sugar. And unfortunately, they moved to a new location. They upgraded their hospital. And when they did that, it didn't quite work for Rome. He didn't like the new place that he was in. And obviously, whenever you make a move like that in a business, there's a lot of time that has to be set in getting things right. And he wasn't getting the attention that he wanted. It's hard to say what would have been the best thing to do for him at that time. But because he started to destroy his feathers, he was chewing on them and they all looked pretty frazzled. Oh, I love you. Thank you, baby. Thank you for raising your wing for me. Roman raises his wing to show his affection to me, along with other things. We had another bird that had become adapted to the situation at the sanctuary and was looking for a home at the time. That was back when we used to actually do adoptions out. And so what we did is we did a trade. And I brought this one home to the sanctuary. The big issue with him was that once I got him in the cage, he wouldn't come out. In fact, when I was at the animal hospital and I tried to get him out to come with me, he just ran to the back of the cage, way up to the top, and just was shaking in fear. So I tried and tried to get him out of the cage to coax him out, and he wouldn't come. And finally, I went to the manager of the hospital and said, could you give me a little bit of a hand getting him out? So I got him here and put him in the loner cage they gave me for him, and he wouldn't come out of it. Wouldn't come out. So it was pretty obvious that he needed a new place to be in a little larger space. So we got him a 507 King's cage, which is, let's face it, these guys actually need to be flying free. But for as far as cages go, it's pretty large. It's 4 foot wide by 3 foot by 6 foot tall. To get him into that cage, though, because all he ever did when I approached him was just cower in fear, I had to take apart the old cage with him in it, which I could do safely. So I took the side panels off, and I got to the point where he realized there was no cage there. So he briefly stepped up on my arm. I got him in the new cage. I took my time because I felt that we had the time and there was no reason to push him. For the feather problem, he started on a little bit of haloperidol. And that also eased his nervousness, where he started approaching me a little more. That small amount of haloperidol, 0.07 milliliters, helped with his nervousness. He stopped chewing his feathers, and he started looking out around a bit more and showing interest when I approached the cage. Now, when other people would come over, he would launch at them at this point, and not in the way you might think, but just to be held. And he would curl up right in the crook between their arm and their body, and he would usually say, love, 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 while exhibiting mating behavior. And I said, love, 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 didn't I? Yeah, I did. So his tail would raise, and he'd start flashing his tail and that kind of thing. So he went from hanging in the cage to a little more interested in the world around him, but nervous if you reached inside the cage.
Coco has issues with the cameras and tripods. Darth Dawn had to take her away to another galaxy because she would not stop her alarm call. Alarm calls differ from screaming because they are a warning call about something in the environment that should not be there. Usually, screaming is an attempt to get something such as attention. So Coco is now in detention. Well, she's in the main bird room, probably chewing away at the door to get back in.
Hi, Cause. So in the room today, we have Cause, Cozy, Cosma, also called our crash test pilot, and the Stay Puft Marshmallow, too. And Sugar, Sugar Bird, and Simone, Simone, also known as Gozer the Gozerian, and Sal. Coco is no longer with us. She's out in the living room. She, again, freaked out because of the tripods. So, what are you going to do? Play with the wood? Peaches isn't in here with us today because she wanted to play in her cage. It's a rarity, but once in a while she'll want to stay in her cage, and today is one of those days. So, given the opportunity, she said no. So once Roman was in his new cage, he started showing a lot more interest in the world. He had enough room to move around where if he wanted to get away, he could, without having to climb to the top of the cage all the way in the back. It's a good time to note that cages that are angle cages that go in the corner are just not good cages, and round cages as well are not a good idea. The problem with the cages that go in the corner is that they really don't have that much room to move around. And generally that means there's nowhere to go if they're frightened. And that's not a good idea. It's a good idea to make sure that they have a place where they can go. Right, Roman? Right? So a nice big cage. They can move around. It's not too close to a window. Because, we've actually had hawks fly down and scare the birds. If there's a window there and they see inside, they will fly down at the window. So that could give a bird a heart attack. And one of the birds here, actually Lorelei, had that situation happen. And I didn't know what was going on until too late. And so when she tried to fly out of the cage, I was leaving. So I tried to keep her in it. And it took me a good 2 to 3 months to get her back to the point where she was comfortable with my hands because of that. So try to keep the cages away from windows where they could be frightened by a hawk or something else that goes by. But he got used to it. He had a lot of room to move around, lots of toys to play with, although he wouldn't play with toys in the beginning. He was used to playing with just leashes that were hung in the cage. And the idea of chewing on wood was foreign to him. But now if you put a leash in his cage, he doesn't show much interest in it. In fact, he'll just ignore it. He wants wood toys. He's kind of specific. He likes to have like an octopus, lots of things hanging off of it, like blocks hanging off. If it's just a straight chain with wood on it, he'll usually only chew on one of those pieces. But if it hangs out and it's spread out, kind of like a Christmas tree, then he'll play more with it, won't you, Roman? Won't you? Are you going to show everybody how vicious you are? Yes, you're such a vicious tree. At the animal hospital, they did show me, several people showed me the bites, the scars they had from bites from him. But it appears it was strictly from fear. And it's strange. He was afraid of two things. What he was most afraid of are paper towels and spray bottles. The cleaning supplies, in other words. So and just cleaning his cage and going in and bothering him must have, I'm just guessing here, but that must have set him to the point where he didn't like those things. So he became focused on people when they came in. You know, people would come to visit, and he would want to get out of the cage and rush to them. And then a lot of the time, he would just sit in the cage doing nothing. So the trick was to work with him, you know, try putting new different types of toys in his cage, hanging leashes off some of the toys because he was used to leashes. So if he's playing with a leash and there happened to be a piece of wood there, he might bite it. Well, eventually, kind of blending those things together, he got to where he would... You would use the toys that we built. So, and in time, it took about a little over a year for him to just basically step up when I asked him to. And it's still about every other time he'll do it immediately. Sometimes with coaxing, a little, come on, Roman, that kind of thing. Come on, let's go. You go do something. And other times he just doesn't want to. And depending on the situation, most of the time he gets to make his own decision. Now today he came right out. He came right out. Didn't you, Roman? Didn't you? Oh, I see you're putting your tail up. You like all the attention, huh? You like all the attention? Do you? Yeah. He has... Yeah, when he came to us, he had several phrases. He says, I love you. And he would say, love, 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 love. And those are the two most common things that he said. He's never said, love, 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 love to me. He's never said that. But he has said it to many people who come over. He hasn't said it recently. What he says for me, and he has a phrase he only uses for me, is I love, love you. He'll say, I love, love you. Which is different from anything else that he says. He does say hello, and he says it in a number of different ways. He has a little sound he makes when he wants your attention, and kind of sounds like a whine, a very loud whine. So he'll make that sound, kind of a kind of sound when he wants something. He clacks his beak when he's happy. Don't you, Roman? Don't you? Don't you? Don't you? He's never bitten me. A few times he would do what we call fear. We don't know. We just see behavior. And you should never assume something because you could be wrong. But what he will do is run away and then turn away like this. And we would call that a fear response. But we don't know what emotions they're actually expressing. So whenever I approached him, if I notice, and you should do this with any bird, if you notice that they turn away, or if they take a step away from you, you lean their body away from you, then you should stop and take a step back. Just move away one step and stand there until they seem to be calm, until they stand normally, they're not turning away from you. And then you can move maybe a half step forward and see if you get a reaction. If you don't, you stand there for a while and you move in. Did a lot of that with Rome to get him used to me. And as I say, he's never bitten me. There are some times when it looked like he might because you could tell he was nervous and he was turning his head from side to side. But again, I would step away in those situations. So eventually he stopped making what appeared to be threatening motions. Even the day that I took his cage apart and put him in the new cage. He opened his beak and leaned it forward a couple of times, but it was not really a threatening motion. It was just what he had always done to get someone to back away. And at least that's the way it appears. So he'd been on a pretty good diet. He was on Harrison's pellets and fresh fruit and vegetables every day. So he was on a good diet, leafy greens and that kind of thing. So he was in good health when he came to us. I mean, they did a good job of taking care of him as far as his physical needs. And there's only so much you can do when you're running a business. But his problem was psychological due to being moved from one place to another and not feeling comfortable in the new place. So the job was to make him feel comfortable. Then once that happened, it became time to try to slowly introduce him to other birds. He has never gotten along with other birds terribly well. He doesn't bite them, but he threatens them with the open beak and the lunging. He used to do that from 2 feet away. Now he'll do it when they get so close. So instead of showing that behavior here, he shows that behavior here. He doesn't have much of a territorial boundary between him and a human, but when it comes to other birds, he does. Right, Roman? He will do anything for peanut butter. And as we know, peanut butter is not the safest thing to give birds. Peanuts can have aflatoxin, which is a deadly poison. So he gets very little of it, but he does get a little bit every day. That's how he gets his Haldol. It's haloperidol. It's mixed in a little bit of peanut butter. And he'll call for it. The way he calls for it is, I love you, I love you, I love you. Isn't that what you do, Roman? He eats the mash that I make, but to get him to eat the mash is another thing. The way you have to do it is you have to take a little, just a tiny bit of peanut butter on a Kraft stick, and you take that and you hold it up, and he's trained. If you say, who do you love? He says, I love you. So when he says that, and only when he says that, you give him a bite off his stick. The second he takes that one little bite, you take it and stick it in the mash. And so, and then you make sure there's a nice bunch of mash on the end of the stick. At that point, he'll eat everything that's on the stick to get down to that tiny bit of peanut butter. And then if you leave the room, which I do because I'm going to get birds, one bird after another, and he's the third bird to come out. So as I'm doing that, he'll just, because I'm not in the room, he'll just start eating the mash that's in his cup. And he has his mash up on a perch, on a cup that's mounted to the perch. That's where he likes it, right, Roman? Right? Yeah. That's where you like it, isn't it? Isn't it? That's a good moment of bird. That's a good moment of bird. Hi. Hi, sweetie. Hi. Hi, sweetheart. Now, this is a bird that people thought was aggressive, and it's not in their nature to be aggressive, so there had to be something that needed to change in his environment for his normal personality. His deepest personality to come out. And once we got through to him, this is what we found. We found this very loving and sweet bird, which we know that they're not sweet. I mean, it's a human trait. But he is social with humans. He's interested. He plays. He chews wood. Yes, it took a while to get him to chew wood, too. He would look at it, take one little nibble, and leave it. That's not normal behavior for one of these guys either. Is it, Roman? Is it, Roman? Oh, you're going to do... Oh, thank you, Roman. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, boy. Uh-huh. Thank you. Whenever he puts his wing out like that, I say, thank you. Yeah, I know. Yes, how are you going to do it for me on the other side, too? Okay. Okay. Oh, thank you, Roman. Thank you. Thank you, sweetheart. Thank you. Good boy. Thick boy. And he's still nervous in new situations. He doesn't leave the sanctuary much because he doesn't... When he's outside, he's terribly nervous. You take him outside the building and you walk around with him. And he's looking everywhere like something's going to come at him. He's not anywhere as bad as he was when he first came here. He's much better about that. But as far as taking him, putting him in a cage and taking him, when we have to take him to the vet, he doesn't care much for the experience. Where a lot of birds party, Bob bounces up and down, sings with the music. He likes to listen to Elvis or Marilyn Manson. I don't know. He just, I guess it's the harder songs by Elvis and the harder ones by Manson. Those are what he likes. And this guy, as far as music goes, doesn't seem to have a lot of preference except for one thing. He has an absolute love for Willie Nelson. Aw, thank you, sweetheart. Thank you. Aw, good boy. Thank you. He has an absolute love for Willie Nelson. In fact, I got Honeysuckle Rose for him. And I know that I could probably play any part in that movie now, because I've seen it so many times. If he doesn't seem to be happy, all you need to do is play Honeysuckle Rose for him. Now, the first time that I did that, the first time that he saw that movie, he sat on a perch, and as you know, if you know anything about these guys, you watch them, they can rotate their eyes forward and see stereoscopic like we do. They can turn their eyes that way. He sat for the whole length of that movie and watched the entire thing. I was completely amazed. Now he doesn't do that. What he does is he'll be playing while the movie's on, and he will stop when Willie's on and look at Willie. He knows the scenes that Willie's going to be in, so he stops and watches Willie, and then as soon as Willie's off the screen, he's back to playing, and that goes on for the whole movie. He just only watches those scenes of Willie. He prefers the scenes where Willie is singing. In fact, I actually contacted Willie Nelson through email and talked to his daughter, and I sent them a little clip of him watching the movie, but I have the clip of him watching the entire movie. I have most of the clip, so I didn't start taking the video until I realized that he wasn't going to take his eyes off the screen. But at night, he gets the last, as everybody goes into their sleeping cages and they get their snack, he stays out for about an extra 15 minutes, and he likes that separate time. And while he's out, he gets to listen to Willie. And his favorite Willie songs are Angel Flying Too Close to the Ground. That's his favorite song. And then Blue Skies. Those are the two he likes the best, isn't it? Isn't that true? Is that true, Roman? Is that true, Roman? So with Roman, it's important to give him his dose of Willie Nelson. And then he has to have a little bit of peanut butter. Hi, sweetheart. Hi. Hi, sweetie. And that's where his Halval has to go in. You just put it on a craft stick. Isn't that right, Rome? Rome bird. Now, with nervous birds, ones that are frightened, that are showing behavior that indicates that they would rather be somewhere else than where they are, it's important to get them into the largest cage that you can, in a place where they feel that they can run away if they need to find out what their favorite food is. And generally, the way you find out what the favorite food is to just lay out a tray of different treats and things. And that would include anything except the normal pellets in the diet. So little papayas and banana chips and whatever. In this case, the peanut butter was it. But you lay it all out and you present them with it when they're hungry, like first thing in the morning, if you haven't had any food in their cage overnight. And they'll go for whatever their favorite thing is first. So then you take that out of their normal diet. I know. I know. You take that out of their diet. I love you. Aw, thank you, Roman. Thank you. Thank you, boy. I know. You take that out of their diet and you use it only with training. So once I figured out that he liked the peanut butter, by just putting a tiny bit on a craft stick, I could get his attention. And that helped to make him more interested in paying attention to me as well. So he started coming out of his cage more frequently because he saw that if he would come over and do that, that he would get just a tiny bit of peanut butter. Whenever you're training like that, whatever it is, you want to use the least amount you possibly can to get their interest. And in the case of the peanut butter, it's obvious we want to keep that reduced because it's not the best thing in the world for them. Oh, thank you, bro, man. Yeah. It's not the best thing in the world for them, so. But in general, once they get full, if you're training a bird and they're full, you're probably done training, so. And also with training, and he's a good example of that, you only want to train for short periods of time, 10 minutes or less, and you make sure that when you finish the training, you finish it on a positive note. If for some reason they won't do the behavior you want, say you're trying to get him to step up, but he won't step up, but he'll target. Target is just if you have something between your fingers or in your hand, and they know that, and you put it out and they go to it, that's targeting to your hand. So if you can get them to target over here and get them to target over there a couple of times, with birds that will step up without a problem, you just get them to step up, a few times on your hands, finish the routine that way. And once you've done that, you finish that routine, left on that positive note, then the next time you come back to train, the bird's got a positive feeling about it. Works the same with us. If you've ever had a job where they didn't give you your paycheck on Friday, what are you doing, sweetie? What are you doing? You're all excited. Well, I know. You're all excited, aren't you? Do you know that this video is about you? Somehow I don't think you do. I don't think so. Yeah, you know something about you is fun and focused today, don't you? You know that, don't you? Don't you? Whatever you say, sweetheart. But this kind of behavior that you see in him, which is positive behavior that most people would appreciate, is their basic nature in the wild. When they're not mated, mated birds don't show that kind of behavior to other birds. They may preen each other on the head, even if they're not mated, but they don't usually show this kind of behavior. Hi, sweetie. Hi, baby. Hi, Roman bird. Thank you, sweetie. Thank you. So, if you're dealing with a bird that doesn't want to have anything to do with you or anything to do with another person in the home, it's important that the person who's having that problem be the one that give the reinforcers, the treats, to the bird. And you can start off by just walking over to the cage, they jump in the cage, they hide up in the back, you put that treat down in the cage, and you walk away. You can even leave the room if that's a problem. By the time you come back, you just kind of peer in to make sure they've taken the treat. So once they've done that for you, then you can slowly work closer and closer. You leave the treat, you walk almost out of the room, and you sit down. They go over and get the treat. And you eventually will be able to hand them the treat. Take your time. Sometimes it happens really fast. Sometimes it may take months. But just work with them until they feel comfortable. We generally, oh, thank you, Roman. Thank you, baby. We generally don't know what it is that caused the problem, and it's not necessary to know. You deal with the problems that you're dealing with now. If you have some kind of an idea what caused it, it might help you frame a program to change that behavior, but it's not necessary. You just have to deal with the behaviors you're seeing. So, so a bird that was labeled, and that's another thing, we tend to label things in our world. He was labeled as aggressive. In fact, I was at the hospital one time, and the veterinarian who is the owner, I believe, at least the primary in the corporation, wanted to take a picture of me with one of the birds. And I said, well, I'll take Roman. And someone else in the room said, oh, well, he bites. And, of course, he didn't bite me. He was a little nervous because this was after their move. And in the new place, he wasn't comfortable. But he was fine. Weren't you? Weren't you? You were just fine, weren't you? So keeping him happy like this requires monitoring the toys he has, making sure he has enough toys, enough wood to chew on. He needs to be taken out individually, although right now he seems just as happy being out with several birds in the room. And that's probably, I'm guessing here, because I have kept the birds off of me, the other birds off of me for the most part. So he has just the focus. But he needs to have the focus on him for at least 20 minutes a day. And he needs to be out, like most of them, at least 3 or 4 hours a day. And you can do that in most situations, as long as you have parrot-proofed a room. And it's impossible to be perfect, but you can get appliance, those appliance metallic covers that go over cords. You can get appliance corrugated metal covers and put those over electrical cords in the room. And then you have to make sure that you have them sealed at each end. I have to put a new end on them, obviously. So once you cut the cord, you put the corrugated protector over it and then put the end on. Make sure you have it so they can't get into that wire. They're terribly good at finding the weak spot on anything. And that's behaviorally as well. If you've got a weak spot, a spot where you can be easily manipulated, then they're going to find it. And that includes Roman, isn't it? Yes, it includes Roman. When he wants my attention, he's lifting his wings, so. His prognosis is good in the long run. He's going to do just fine. As long as he's given attention, he's not forced into situations he can't handle. If you were to take him and shove him in another cage in a different room, there's a good chance he would go right back inside of himself. One thing that helps to mitigate that too, which I should have mentioned on some of the other podcasts, is that we have a sleeping room. So every day he goes from his cage at night to my lap for some time, and then he goes into another cage, which is his sleeping cage. And that makes a big difference. He's moving cages all the time, so he's not quite as hooked on the cage that he has during the day. He's in and out of that cage every day for sure. And I think it's critical that if you have birds, they should have a sleeping cage. And that way there really isn't any excuse. You're so busy you can't take them out in any particular day. They have to come out because they have to come out of their sleeping cage. There you go. There's that behavior. See, a bird got close. A bird got close to him. Cause got close to him, and he did what I was talking about. Although he didn't lunge. Did you lunge? I didn't see a lunge. No, you didn't. No, you didn't. That's a good boy. So that's about as close as he'll tolerate to another bird. Any closer than that, and he's going to have a reaction. He gets along with Cecil better than any other bird. He even let Cecil preen him one time. So it's important to watch his diet, because he would eat nothing but peanut butter if he could get away with it. He will eat a little bit of sunflower seed, a few seeds a day. Unlike the other birds, he doesn't seem interested in papaya. Although I've seen him eat it a couple of times. And the same with banana chips. Sometimes he'll nibble on a banana chip. You're getting nervous here. You're just cleaning your feathers. It's all right. I'm not going to get you. It's okay. And he pulled a few coverts and things. This is just because the other bird came over. He reacts to other birds by pulling his feathers. Nothing major, just a little here and there. Right, Roman? Right? Mm-hmm. So it's critical to make sure he gets his food. And the trick that I mentioned with the craft stick with a tiny bit of peanut butter on it, we're talking like an eighth of a teaspoon of peanut butter on it. Let him, say, you have to give him the cue, which is, who do you love? And then he nibbles just a little bit off of it, stick it into the mash, and then he eats it off. He'll eat the mash right off the stick. Sometimes the mash falls off. The way that I make the mash has a lot of squash in it. In fact, even if you leave it sitting out overnight, it doesn't stick to the bowl it's in. There's that much moisture in it. It's the Bob's mash, which Bob has to have, and it seems to be good for all of them. But you got to trick him into eating it. Once he's tricked into it, if you leave the room, he will start eating the mash. So when I got him, he had tiny little poop. That was the other thing. Although he was being fed well and he was physically in good shape, there just wasn't enough poop coming out of him. So on this new mash, he's doing pretty well. Aren't you, babe? I love you. Thank you, sweetheart. Yeah, he's a sweetheart. Mm-hmm. Are we preening or are we picking? Are we preening or are we picking? Socially, he should be exposed to other birds regularly. When he's placed in a situation with people and he shows too much interest in one, he should be taken gently and moved to someone else and then to someone else so he doesn't become too focused on one. It's important that he doesn't get too focused on individuals. He doesn't seem to want to mate with any other birds, so he seems to be safe with females. I wouldn't push that, though, and leave him in a room with females with no supervision. But he does chase away every female I've ever seen, so he does let Coco get into his cage, but he keeps her at a distance, and she doesn't approach him too closely either. They get along in that regard. They can be in the same cage. Aw, thank you, sweetheart. They can be in the same cage. Right, Roman? You need to make sure he has toys. He likes, like I say, the spidery ones with lots of wood coming off of them. As you can see, Roman, let me get your wing out here. It's all right. All right, sweetheart. You see, he's missing feathers here. Those feathers have never come in. And this is something that you'll find in zoos. They'll do this so that the feathers on one wing won't come in. Well, he has that problem on both wings. So he'll never fly. And that throws his balance off. That's something else I failed to mention. It came to this video with a stomach ache this morning, so, but I have to record him, don't I, baby? And it's good to talk about the Roman bird. Yes, it is. The Roman bird. So he doesn't have good balance, and he will tilt and kind of look like he's going to fall over, and then he gets nervous, and this may have been some of the things that sparked the bites, because he was simply trying to hold on. Isn't that right, Roman Bird? Yeah, right. I won't show anybody. No, I'm not going to make you lose your balance. No. They'll just have to believe me, won't they? Yeah. But this is sad when a bird doesn't have the ability to fly and there's nothing you can do about it. It's not just flight. It helps them balance themselves. They use their wings for balance, and he can't do that. But a lot of birds that are labeled as birds that are aggressive, because they do behaviors like this, where they nip once or twice, are not aggressive at all by nature, and it's not in the nature of cockatoos to be aggressive. So if you see that behavior, something has made it. And as my mentor said, you know, behavior is a function of its consequences. So if opening the beak and hissing at another bird keeps them away, well, that looks like that's what he wants. He wants to keep them away. And that's a behavior he can do and keep them away. Right. Quickly going over Roman's issues, he has a lack of balance because he's missing feathers on his primary feathers on his wings. He doesn't move well from one cage to another, from one room to another. He's slow to deal with new situations. He's defensive with other birds. And because he's not naturally pushy, he tends to run away from situations, which actually is more of a bird trait. In the wild, they don't confront to fight predators when they come up. They fly away. So a normal behavior for a bird is to leave a situation. That's what he tries to do. He tries to get out of a situation. Oh, you're going to throw that out of here? You don't want it? You don't like the balls, huh? He doesn't like that toy. I don't know why. Won't play with him. Roman is living proof that a bird that has been labeled as aggressive really isn't. And you can dig down and find the personality inside. Right, Rome? So that's our show. See you next time.
Please visit our website at www.chloesanctuary.org. That's Chloe spelled C-H-L-O-E. You can support us on a per-episode basis by visiting www.patreon.com, that's P-A-T-R-E-O-N, / Chloe Sanctuary.